Welcome, everybody. God bless you. Hope you're having a Merry Christmas this far. It's hard to believe it's already Christmas. Seems like the years go by faster and faster. I want to preach to you from Matthew chapter 2. We'll be looking at the first 12 verses as we start this Christmas season, and I want to tell you, it's a joy to preach at Christmas. It's a joy to preach at any time, but one of the things that ought to get us excited is the Lord Jesus Christ. Christmas is about His appearing. We get more excited, I believe, at the Easter time, when we think about His death, burial, and resurrection, when you look at the significance of what that means for us as Christians. And so this morning we're going to start. This, in my mind, always starts a new church year when I start at the Christmas season, thinking about next year and what the year may hold for us. No one knows what next year is going to bring. I want to tell you, trials and tribulation come in this life. No one is exempt. And unless you are plugged in to the Lord Jesus Christ, I don't know how you could even think about going into the future. The Bible gives us very clear examples of the signs that will precede the Lord's coming again. And I want to tell you, as I look around, I see the signs are everywhere. So this morning, as we start our new church year, as we think about the Christmas season, I want to take a look at the wise men that came to Jesus. Now, ladies, the men aren't the only that are wise. So I'm going to use the term wise people a lot. And I really want to hear amens from the, thank you. Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. We get to the account of Matthew. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men, the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for our church. Thank you for your word. Thank you for Christmas. Thank you for the many, many blessings that you have brought, Lord, just by your coming the first time. And Lord, we look forward to your coming the second time, when we all go home, when all of heaven is gathered, when the saints on earth are caught up into the air, and those who have died in you, in Christ, will be raised. What a glorious time that's going to be. And Father, we look at the world around us, and we see so many of your predictions just coming true at an unprecedented pace. And Father, we just thank you. We honor you. We pray, O Lord, that you would keep us until that day, that you would use us for your glory. We pray for those who might be lost, that they would not put that off any longer, Lord, but that your Holy Spirit would draw them to yourself. I pray that this morning upon any that may be here. In Jesus' name, amen. Wise people. Wisdom is an attribute of God. It's not of man. Wisdom comes from the Bible. There is no wisdom apart from God. There's a lot of intelligence. There's a lot of education. True wisdom is from God alone. That's why the Bible tells us, if any man, if any woman lacks wisdom, let them ask of God, who gives liberally. And so this morning, we're going to take a look at these men who God calls wise. And there are many examples of people, if you think about it, who the Bible tells us were filled with wisdom. They were, their lives were characterized, if you will, by wisdom. I think of Enoch and I think of Noah. They lived for the Lord. They were wise enough to walk with God while the world around them lived for pleasure. And Enoch and Noah were saved. They were both saved while all the others perished. The Bible tells us about Ruth. Ruth was a Moabite. She was a foreigner to Israel, God's chosen people, but she was married into a family, a Jewish family. She was wise enough to tell her Jewish mother-in-law at the death of her husband, and her mother-in-law had lost her husband. Ruth says to her, "Entreat me not to leave you or to turn back from following after you, for wherever you go, I will go. And wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God." Her sister-in-law, on the other hand, with the same opportunity, turned away and went back into her old life and went back to a life apart from God. Because Ruth followed wisdom, she became from an outsider to the into the ancestry line of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says Andrew was wise because he brought people to Jesus. He brought his brother. He brought many to Jesus. There was David, whom the Bible shows us was wise enough to say, "The Lord is my shepherd." There was Solomon. The Bible says the wisest man who ever lived. And then, in this story, the Christmas story, there's the men whom God calls wise men. The term appears 44 times in Scripture, wise men. Paul uses it in 1 Corinthians 10:15. I'll give you an example. He's speaking. He says, "I speak as to wise men. Judge for yourselves," he goes on to say. "But I speak to you as wise men." That term, the words mean thoughtful. They mean intelligent, but having sound judgment. And that's what comes from God. So what's the characteristic of someone who's wise? What makes the men of this scripture wise? I suppose many of us, when we get to heaven, it would be pretty good if God would look at our life and say, "That was a thoughtful, intelligent person who lived a life worthy of God saying, well done." In Matthew's account, the Christmas account, we see these wise men. They come from the east, the Bible says. We don't know a lot about them. We just know that they came from the east and they came to worship Jesus. Now, this is something magnificent. God gave them a light to follow. It's the Bethlehem star. It's the Christmas star. If you ever watch a Christmas play, it's one of the parts of every play. Every child that's ever been part of a Christmas play can tell you about the Star of Bethlehem. And the wise men follow this star until it brings them face to face with the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's what God's light does. God's light will lead us until we come to the place where we can come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. Wise people today are no different than back in this day. They still, today, we still can share some of the same qualities that made these men wise, made these people wise. The characteristics of these are available to us, and to those who had come to worship that first Christmas can be with those of us who worship now. So I want you to notice that this is what the message is all about. What is it that makes someone wise? For God to call us wise. first I want you to see a major point that wise people will always follow the light which God gives. Now, the light for you may be different than the light for me. Amen? But God will shine His light upon any who will seek Him. Now, there's some fascinating truths in this story, and we're going to get to some of those. But these people that were called wise men, sometimes in Scripture translated magi, and so these magi were skilled in philosophy. They were very intelligent in medicine. They were skilled in science and astronomy. But they were also students of Scripture and of prophecy. It's amazing to me, one of the smartest things I see in this passage, the educated in this day studied the Bible. They thought of the Bible in high regard. And these wise men regarded Scripture very, very high. And they studied it. The Bible tells us to study the Word, to be students of the Word, so that we don't find ourselves ashamed. And these magi were students of Scripture. They studied the heavens. And so their attention was certainly alerted when they saw the star that suddenly appeared. No one knows for sure where they came from, but most are pretty sure they came from Babylon, and I'll tell you why. It says they came from the east. Babylon is east of Jerusalem, and we're told that that's where they came from, that direction, the east. Babylon, ancient Babylon, is modern-day Iraq, and it was a pagan place then. And the Jews had been taken captive to Babylon and spent some 70 years in captivity there. And you remember the stories of that. We saw many rise to prominence. Our vacation Bible school last year was about some of these that rose to prominence in Babylon. Daniel rose to prominence. He rose into the leadership, if you will, of the government there. There were Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We've all saw the stories of Daniel in the lion's den and the fourth man in the fire. And so Daniel, while he's in Babylon, writes much of his writing, the scriptures that God used him to write. Much of it was written in Babylon. In Babylon, Ezekiel was there, the prophet, and Ezekiel wrote a lot of his prophecy in Babylon. And many of the Psalms, some of the Psalms, were written while they were in exile living in Babylon. So in Babylon, these magi would have had full access to the Scriptures. They would have had complete access to the Old Testament. And maybe as they studied, maybe it was Numbers chapter 24 that got their attention. There are many prophecies that could have gotten their attention. But Numbers 24 says, a star shall come out of Jacob, a scepter shall rise out of Israel. And so these men that God calls wise understood the Scriptures. They studied the Scriptures. They had high regard for the Word of God. They saw a kingdom coming, and it was God's kingdom. So God provided all the light they needed to lead them to Christ. Because they sought Jesus and they traveled a great distance to worship Him, Matthew says they're wise. I think of the difficulty they experienced in Ezra chapter 7. It took Ezra, when they were returning from captivity from Babylon, Ezra was with, I believe it was the first remnant that goes back. And Ezra's there. The Bible tells us in Ezra 7, it took 4 months to make the journey. Now, maybe these magi had a smaller caravan and they made it a little faster. But nevertheless, can you imagine the difficulty? We've seen His star and we've come to worship. I look around in our day-to-day, not only was it difficult terrain, to travel. There were no motels along the way. 4 months. They didn't ride in automobiles, amen. In the Christmas stories, we see them riding camels. Some say maybe it was horses. No one really knows. Nevertheless, it wasn't an easy journey. And today we have people, when you talk about worship, coming to worship, they saw a star and they had the prophecies concerning this king to be born. And they responded. And they traveled. Today, if it's raining, it's hard to fill a church up. The biggest cult in America, according to Adrian Rogers, is the cult of the comfortable. As I look around, I pray, Lord, have mercy on half-hearted worship. Many, many times I see this in our own land. The message of these wise men shows us that wisdom is available. The same wisdom that God gave them is available to you. It's available to me if we would just look to Jesus. God provided three things that I see. Three things I see in this passage that help them find Jesus. And the same three are still available to us today. I'm going to refer to them as light, the light God gave. I'm thinking about that first point. Wisdom is the ability, the desire to follow whatever light God offers you. So what is some of the light he's given to us? What's some of the things we have that perhaps is even more or better than what they had in that day? I want you to see, first and foremost, they received the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit's a fascinating study. I can already hear somebody saying, well, I thought the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost. Well, the Holy Spirit is God. Can I get an amen? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They're three in one. So the Holy Spirit's always existed. It's just that in New Testament times, as we live, this is where we have it better. The Holy Spirit indwells us. We carry him with us. Jesus said, it's better that he go to the Father, because God will send what? The Comforter to come, and he will be with us. These wise men, it wasn't exactly the same. God would place his Spirit upon whom he would choose. But God's Spirit, nevertheless, is still active in the Old Testament, all throughout the Old Testament. And so we see it was God himself that paid a visit to these men, whether they were in Babylon, I believe they were, and he put it in their hearts to find Jesus Christ. The desire that they had in their heart, God is the one who put it there. And it's God who puts it in us as well. I want to tell you something this morning. Perhaps you're here and you've never even really thought about the Lord. Just the fact that you are here this morning tells me somebody's been praying for you. Why do I say that? Well, I'm a believer in Scripture. I believe it literally. I believe it plainly. I believe it's the Word of God. Now listen to what the Bible says in Romans chapter 3, verse 11. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. And I hear people all the time say, I sought the Lord. I looked for the Lord and I found him. I want to tell you, the only reason you or I would look for the Lord is because God looked for us first. God placed his Spirit on your behalf to draw you to himself. Jesus said, no one comes to the Father except the Father draws them. And so God is working on your behalf. Just the fact that you are sitting here this morning tells me God's working on you. But here's the point. What have you done with the light? What are you doing with the light God is offering? His Spirit will not tarry with us forever. Amen? And no one knows. So what makes a person wise? When they saw the light of God, they responded diligently. They didn't tarry. I want to tell you, no one knows what tomorrow holds. It's been a heck of a week. And I'm sure there will be tougher weeks. But I will tell you this. God is still with us. And He's declared, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. And I didn't look for Him. And I'm so thankful that God went looking for me. No one seeks after God. No one understands the things of God. And many, many times we hear people say, I found Him. No, He found you. Look at John chapter 15. Jesus Himself, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask the Father in my name, He may give you. So you see, when God is dealing with you and God is dealing with me, these are things we need to take very seriously. So how about you? Have you responded to the Lord Jesus? Or do you still hear the Word of God, see the light of God, and then turn and walk away? The Bible says that's very foolish. The fool says in his heart, there is no God. And these wise men were wise in the mind of God and in the mind of Matthew, who wrote the Gospel of Matthew. They were wise because they sought the Lord. When they heard His voice, when they saw His light, they followed. I'm going to give you one more about Him choosing us. This is one of my favorites. Not only did He choose me, but this is one that gets me thinking. He chose me before He ever formed the world. He knew me. Wait a minute. I was born in 1961. I believe the world was formed way before that. God chose us. He chose you. He chose me before the foundation of the world. Look at Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4. Just as He chose us, Paul says, in Him, before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love. John writes it like this: we love because He first loved us. We love Him, but it's because He first loved me. He first loved you. And so it was God who put it in the hearts of these men to seek Him. I hear many, many times people say we need seeker-friendly services. Well, I want to tell you something. The Holy Spirit's job is to draw them. If we preach the Word of God, let the Word of God have its work. And if we pray for those who are lost, the Holy Spirit will draw men to the Lord Jesus Christ. So they received the ministry of the Holy Spirit, but they also read the message of Scripture. They had the Old Testament Scriptures. Daniel wrote his prophecy. I don't know if you've ever spent some time reading Daniel chapter 9 and you wonder why many people didn't look for the coming, the first coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Daniel pinpointed almost to the day when the Lord would enter Jerusalem. And Daniel wrote way before Jesus was born. But Daniel in chapter 9 pinpointed almost to the day that Jesus would come into Jerusalem. Nobody was looking. The wise men are called wise. The Bible says, listen, look back at verse 1. I'm going to go back and read a little bit again. Wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, where is He who's been born King of the Jews? for we have seen his star in the east, and we've come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. So they said to him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet. Many, many times in the Christmas plays, we see the wise men come, and maybe in the Christmas play, they go straight to the manger. But in the Bible story, the wise men are following the light which God has given them, and the star leads them to Jerusalem. Now, when they get to Jerusalem, which is the capital, by the way, when they get to Jerusalem, they begin to ask, where is he born King of the Jews? And what is fascinating, no one knew what they were talking about. So here is Israel, the nation whom God had given the scripture, the people whom God himself had chosen for himself. And the greatest messianic prophecy to be fulfilled is being fulfilled this night. No one knows. The wise men came from a very long distance. They traveled over rugged terrain, dangerous. There were bandits, there were thieves along the way, some 4 months of a journey, because they came to worship. They knew the place of Jesus' birth because they knew the Word of God. The Jews, whom had received the scriptures, needed to be reminded, and the priests and the scribes and the rabbis, I'm sure they all had an answer. And as I think about this in the first coming, I believe in America the second coming is going to be quite the same. How many people that have knowledge of the scripture, knowledge of what the Bible says, how many will be left behind because they ignored the Word of God? The second coming will be much the same as the first. God's Word is available to anyone who would receive it and read it. But many will miss the rapture because they're living for everything else rather than Jesus Christ. They live for pleasure. I see many kids, teenagers. Many people think, oh, well, maybe they're not at the age of accountability. The age of accountability is the minute you recognize you've sinned, that you're a sinner. The moment you understand what sin is, you are cut off from Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And so the very moment a young person understands what sin is about and that they have committed it, they need salvation. Many will be left behind. I can almost hear the wailing and the crying. But it'll be too late. The Bible prophesied in minute detail about Jesus and his first coming. Do you know there's twice as many prophecies about the second coming as there is the first? Amen. Twice as many warnings. They ignored his first coming. Look at Matthew chapter 2, verse 6. When the wise men asked, where is this king born? We've come to worship him. They quoted Micah chapter 5, verse 2. It's right there in Matthew. Matthew pulls it out for us. This is the passage that they had, that they quoted. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. The wise men understood this prophecy. They understood that the Bible was saying there's a king that's going to be born. There is a king that's coming, and it's the kingdom of God. And they traveled this distance. They came from through all the danger and all the difficulty. It all was worth it for what they were going after. It was the Lord Jesus Christ. So how about your worship? You know, someone told me one time worship can be translated like this: worth-ship. You come because you have decided it's worth our time. It's worth whatever it costs me. And by the way, we pay very little today. Can I get an amen? Compared. We have air-conditioned buildings, comfortable seats, and they came to worship the Lord. He was born King of the Jews. My goodness, he's still a mere child. And you see their faith. We've come to worship him. It was by the word of God. They had the light, the star of Bethlehem, to lead them. They had received the ministry of the Holy Spirit. God put the desire in their hearts. But they also had read the Holy Scriptures. Thirdly, they responded to the miracle of the star. Back in verse 2 of chapter 2, I think. Where is he who's been born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east. We've come to worship him. Look at verse 7. Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search carefully for the young child. Now you know what Herod's going to do. He's going to determine how old he thinks the child is, and then he's going to kill every child that's even close to that age. He could have passed for a good politician today. Go and search carefully for the young child, and when you have found him, bring back word to me that I may come and worship him also. Yeah, right. And when they heard the king, they departed, and behold, the star, there it is again, which they had seen in the east, went before them. Now that's fascinating to me. Someone says, what was this? Someone says a comet. Well, nah, a comet is here and is gone. This was a miracle of God. A star that moved and guided them. They followed this, and it led them. It pointed them. I want to tell you, when God gives you his light, it will always point to the Lord Jesus Christ. Behold, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. When they heard the king, they departed. The star they had seen in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. Now, in the Christmas stories, we always see the wise men on the night Jesus was born at the manger. But the Bible tells us Jesus was a young child in a house. My goodness, it took 4 months to make the journey. Perhaps they had to gather some things together to prepare. I don't know. But for whatever reason, we don't know how exactly old the child was. I know there's some things about the days of purification and Jesus taking the baby to the temple. That's some 40 days after. You can go through all that. But the point I'm looking at is, the Bible's just simply telling me this star led them to the house, the exact house where Jesus was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and they worshiped it. Sometimes it's tough. I'm having a tough time right now. This voice just doesn't want to cooperate. What does it cost us to worship? Whatever it costs, it's worth it. Do not forsake the assembling of yourselves, as some were already doing. God calls it the Lord's Day. The Star of Bethlehem led them straight to Jesus, and God knew what it would take. God knew exactly what they needed to get them there. So here's the point. Has God touched your heart? Has God been speaking to you? He knows exactly what you need. But here's the thing. You can walk away. You can turn and walk away from Him. But we don't know how long His Spirit will continue. Many today are toying with that. Let me tell you something about the rapture that fascinates me. Do you realize when Jesus comes in the air and He calls His church home, that all the saints of God who are alive, in a moment, in an instant, in the twinkling of an eye, they're going to disappear. And the graves, those graves that hold the bodies of those who died in Jesus Christ, they're going to open. And in a moment, in an instant, the twinkling of an eye. How fast is that? Heck, I don't know. But it's real fast. And it's all going to change. And I want to tell you what this world, there's going to be chaos in this world when many suddenly disappear. And the Holy Spirit is in us. Are you following my drift? God speaking to someone today, and they've been putting it off, thinking I got time. We don't know how much time. The Star of Bethlehem led these to Jesus, and God did whatever it took to get them there. But they had to respond. They had to follow. They had to believe enough that it caused them to act. And so I see the miracle of the star. Now, how does God speak to us today? Well, maybe it won't be a Christmas star. If I would love to see one. But how does God? It's just as much a miracle the way God speaks today. How does the Bible say God speaks? How does God send His word today? He may send a messenger to you. We just finished a sermon on angels. Angels are God's messengers. But let me tell you who else is a messenger. You are. And I am. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, it says, "You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." It might be a messenger God sends. As someone came to you and told you about Jesus. That's God dealing with you. Romans chapter 10. I tell Tanya all the time, she tells me my feet are ugly. I tell her my feet are beautiful. You prove it. "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on Him in whom they've not believed? And how shall they believe in Him in whom they've whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. I don't know what kind of light God's going to send to you, what kind of light he has sent to you, but by the authority of the word of God, I can tell you he will do all that is necessary. But you got to respond. I'm going to close. Wise people follow God's light. Let me tell you, I've never considered myself real smart. There was a moment in my life when I made the wisest choice I could ever have made. It's the moment I said, Lord Jesus, save me. I'm a sinner, and I need salvation. I've messed up. I've fallen. Lord, I need you to come into my heart and to change my life. I want to tell you, it's the wisest thing I ever did, because God kept his word. What part did I play in it? Nothing, really. The Bible tells me in that condition, I was dead in trespasses and sins. Now, last time I checked, a dead man can't do anything. And there are some here today who are dead people walking. They would argue and say, no, I'm alive. I'm living the life. I'm telling you, you're dead in trespasses and sins. And there is nothing you can do to gain favor with God. It's only about what he has done. And Jesus died on the cross. He who had no sin became God's payment, paid in full if you would receive it. And there are many who are just walking away from that. There are many who play the Christian part, but they know that they know deep inside, I really don't know it. Tell you, that's dangerous. The devil has you right where he wants you. You can fool me, you can fool others, but you can't fool God. He knows. And he's speaking to you. The ministry of the Holy Spirit is alive and well, and he's speaking to you right now. And you've heard the message of Scripture, and you've had the preachers, you've had the witnesses, you've had the messengers come to you. But now it's your choice. All I did was lift my eyes in faith and said, Jesus, save me. And in an instant, my life was changed. So wise people, they follow God's light. Wise people worship. Now, I'm going to get through this pretty quick. There's a whole nother sermon on the worship part. The Bible says they brought gold. We've heard of him who was born of the Jew. Don't miss this. Now, someone says, what does it really matter what they brought, what gifts they brought? Well, number one, have you ever thought about what you're going to get so-and-so for Christmas? Imagine if it was the Lord Jesus. And when the Bible tells us exactly, precisely what they brought, it's for a reason. There's nothing in Scripture that's not important. Can I get an amen? It's all there for a reason. And the Bible says they brought gold, they brought frankincense, and they brought myrrh. The gold is fit for a king. Where is he born, king of the Jews? Good grief, he's only 4 months old. He's king because God's word said he's king. That's their faith. Then they brought frankincense. You know what frankincense was? Incense was used. It speaks of the deity of the child. Not only was he born king, he's born frankincense was used in the temple worship, in worship of God. So did it matter what they brought? They came all the way from Babylon, all that hard journey, and they brought three gifts: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Myrrh leads me to the last one. You know what myrrh was? It was embalming for a burial. Someone asked me one time, do you think the wise men got saved? I'm pretty sure they did. Pretty sure they're going to be in heaven. Why? Because they knew he was king, and they worshipped him. They knew he was God, and they worshipped him. And they knew he would die for our sins. And they brought myrrh. Well, I want to tell you, as I think about this, there are three discoveries we made. And I'm going to recount them. I want you to get this. Three discoveries. The desire of the wise men was put in their hearts by God. Say amen. You have a desire in your heart, you didn't get that on your own. That's God speaking, and you don't need to play with it. We don't know how long he'll speak. Intelligence didn't take them to Jesus. They were smart men. They were magi. They studied science. They studied philosophy. They studied the stars. Yeah, and it was really not alarming that they saw the star, but it was God's star. But it wasn't their intelligence that led them to Jesus. It was God himself. Now, here's the other thing that I learned. Not only the desire in their hearts by God, the intelligence they had was not enough. They needed the Word of God to get them to the Lord Jesus. They needed the Holy Spirit to get them there. But here's the third thing. When they got to Jerusalem, the scribes and the priests, who should have been the first ones at the manger, they simply didn't care. The priests and scribes in Jerusalem, they had the books. That's what they were. They were scribes. They had the Old Testament books, and they had the books of the Word in their hands. And they held them, and they kept them, and they took care of them. They had the Word of God in their hands, and they had it. They would read it with their eyes. But the wise men, they had the Word of God in their minds, and it went into their heart. That's the difference. In Jerusalem, you couldn't find anyone who even cared. The learned people, the educated of Jerusalem, knew where the Lord would be born, but the wise men knew why he was being born. And they come to worship. And heaven was open to them because they loved the truth of God's Word. Ladies and gentlemen, I say this to you. One day Jesus is coming, and he knows who loves his Word. He knows who loves him. Are we perfect? Heavens, no. But our sins have been covered. So the lesson I learned is God offers wisdom today, just as he gave it to these magi. And Christmas is a wonderful time. I'm just like you. I get tired of the commercial Christmas. Matter of fact, I'm about sick of it. Let me say this. If you get more excited about the Christmas and the birth than you do the death and resurrection, then you probably need to take a look at your heart. Because Jesus was born to die. He was sent by God on mission to be the Savior. And as I look at Christmas time, it really begins a new year for me. And it's a wonderful time to worship. It's a wonderful time to share the message. It's a wonderful time to talk to the lost about the greatest gift ever given. gave his son. Let's all stand. As the musicians come forward, I want to tell you it's a great time to examine my heart and ask myself, am I, according to Scripture, according to God, am I living as a wise person? Or am I living as a fool? Whatever God has spoke, won't you come as we sing?